This day, the residents of paradise will be absorbed in their own joys of bliss. Reclining each on a lofty divan, together with his spouse, in shades that please.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wassalatu wassalam ala Sayyidina wa Azimina وحبيب قلوبنا وشفيع نفوسنا أبي القاسم محمد اللهم صل على محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين وأصحابه الغر الميامين الحمد لله الذي جعلنا من المتمسكين بولاية سيدي ومولاي علي بن أبي طالب اللهم صل على محمد الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله أما بعد يقول الله في كتابه الكريم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل لا أسألكم عليه أجرا إلا المودة في القربى The first of our salawat in honor of Rasulullah Muhammad صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم اللهم صل على محمد The second in honor of Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib The third with your loudest voices, in honor of the Imam of our time, Imam Sahib al-Asr wa al-Zaman. Respected scholars, brothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Imam Musa ibn Ja'far, salawatullah wa salamuhu alayhi. Was born on the 7th of Safar in the 128th year after Hijrah and died on the 25th of Rajab in the 183rd year after Hijrah. A man from whose life many a lesson may be learnt and many an outstanding principle may be derived, and a man revered for his patience, his humility, his piety, as well as his justice and the stand against oppression. Imam Musa ibn Ja'far unfortunately has not been studied in the way he should be. There are many who know of his existence, but not many who know about his impact, both spiritually in terms of the legacy he left behind for the religion of Islam, but at the same time in terms of his own character, from which there are so many lessons that can be learned, which can be applied to our everyday lives. When people go and visit his shrine in Baghdad, it is unbelievable to see the number of people who visit his shrine without knowing absolutely anything about his life. There are many who will go towards his shrine, stand there and pay their salutations and regards. But you don't see the same emotion shown by them as they show in other places of pilgrimage. And the reason is that many people do not know much about the life of Imam Musa ibn Ja'far. Had a person studied the life of Imam Musa ibn Ja'far in depth, then he would show a much greater respect and more emotion than the little emotion that is shown by people who have not studied his life. You find many who go to the shrine in Kazmain and will admit that we have been to that shrine, but we do not know much about his life. We stand there, we ask God to forgive us, we ask God to help us, without really having studied the person or the persons buried in that shrine. Therefore tonight, let us examine this man who was tortured more than any other of the Imams of Al-Muhammad and see what impact his life has on our lives today. The Imam, as we said, was born on the 7th of Safar. That's why normally the wilada or the birth of Imam Musa ibn Ja'far is hardly celebrated in our communities. Because Safar is normally a time of grief. It's a time when the family of the Prophet were taken towards the land of Sham. And therefore in many of our mosques, that period, the 40-day period, or in some cases a 68-day period until the Prophet's martyrdom, you find that many of our mosques will not necessarily honor his birth. He was born on the 7th of Safar in an area by the name of Al-Abwa. Al-Abwa was between Mecca and Medina. Mufaddal bin Umar narrates that Imam al-Sadiq salawatullah wa salamuhu alayhi had a home which was a place where he would visit on his journey, for example, towards Hajj, or on his journey from Mecca back to Medina. Mufaddal bin Umar says this place was in an area called Al-Abwa. He says, I used to remember seeing Imam al-Sadiq in the middle of the hottest day, plowing the earth and working. I would say to him, Imam, a man of your knowledge and a man who everybody is willing to work for, why are you working like this? Why don't you let us do the work for you? To which our sixth Imam replied to Mufaddal by saying, and what is the shame in me earning a lawful living? Just like everybody else, there were prophets who all worked. Prophet Idris was a tailor. Prophet Musa, for example, had a job in terms of being a shepherd, let's say. Prophet Dawood used to make the iron and work with iron. Prophet Jesus was a carpenter. The Holy Prophet himself worked for Khadija. Our sixth Imam said that when I come to Al-Abwa, I plow the earth so I earn a lawful living for myself as well. Just because I'm a man of knowledge does not mean I can't earn a living as well. I like you want to earn a living. I like you want to be someone who can afford to buy what you are buying as well. And you found that it was in this area, Al-Abwa, that Imam al-Sadiq, the narration tells us, was sitting with Abu Basir. Abu Basir said, we had our breakfast. He says, Imam al-Sadiq used to have the most grand breakfast. As in, he'd make you eat, and he'd want you to eat, and he'd give you all the dishes. He said, all of a sudden, someone came to Imam al-Sadiq and said to him, your wife Hamida is now facing the moments of labor, and she wants you to be by her side. Imam al-Sadiq left them, he went towards Hamida, and he came back later and he said, I have glad tidings that Allah has given me the best gift, and that is a son whose face resembles the face of Nabi Musa alayhi salam, and therefore I have decided to name him Musa. The only Imam of the Imams of Ahlulbayt who you find is named after a prophet of God previous to the Holy Prophet is Imam Musa ibn Ja'far. Therefore you find Imam Musa ibn Ja'far, his father was Ja'far ibn Muhammad. His mother was Hamida. Hamida was from North Africa. Someone asks the question, why would Imam al-Sadiq marry a woman from Africa? As in, doesn't Imam al-Sadiq have enough women to choose from in Medina? And on top of that, Imam al-Sadiq is a Sayyid. He's from the line of Amir al-Mu'mineen. Aren't Sayyids only meant to marry Sayyidas? Because would you believe in some of our communities today, you have some people who, when their son wants to get married, if their son is a Sayyid from the line of the Prophet, they will say to him, you can only find a Sayyida like you. The son says, but dad, I found a girl who is a good girl, with good piety, with humility, with forbearance, who's generous. No, we are Sayyids, we only marry Sayyids. If Imam al-Sadiq believed in this, why did Imam al-Sadiq marry a lady from North Africa? Imam al-Sadiq could have easily turned around and said, I am the son of Muhammad al-Baqir, who is the son of Zain al-Abidin, who is the son of Ali ibn al-Husayn, who is the son of Husayn, who is the son of Ali. He could have easily, I am from that line, I have to marry only from that lineage. On the contrary, Imam al-Sadiq ends up marrying someone from North Africa, let's say from the area between Morocco and Tunisia. Imam al-Sadiq could have easily turned around and said, I'll marry from Medina. But Imam was highlighting to us, in Islam, we do not have this thing where you only marry someone from your caste. There's no such thing. In Islam, you can marry someone who is of your religion but of a different cultural background. Someone whose race may be different to your race. When Imam marries someone from North Africa, someone could easily turn around and say, Imam al-Sadiq, why are you marrying people of different races? We are Arabs, we only marry Arabs. On the contrary, the Imam, what was he trying to show us? The Imam was trying to show us, never reach a stage in your communities where you have an inch of racism in your waist. Imagine today in Africa, there are Africans who turn around and say to you, I am a servant of yours, but my lineage goes back to Imam Musa ibn Ja'far's mother. What does your lineage go back to? You find that that's quite a strong statement. But Imam Musa ibn Ja'far's mother is Hamida. Hamida is from North Africa. You find therefore that this Hamida, Imam al-Sadiq used to praise her very highly. Imam al-Sadiq used to say, Hamida, Allah is pleased with her, and she is pleased with whatever Allah has given her. And further than this, Imam al-Sadiq used to also say to the ladies of Medina, whenever you have a question to ask, don't ask me, ask my wife Hamida, because my wife answers in exactly the same way I answer. Imagine, Hamida can answer a question like Imam al-Sadiq. At what level must Hamida be? Do you know what level? It's when a husband and wife's relationship moves forward together. In our communities today, either the husband is too religious and the wife isn't, or the wife is too religious and the husband isn't. And what you find, unfortunately, is this causes a bit of friction at home. Sometimes the balance doesn't need to mean both of them have to be religious, but that those both of them are trying to become more and more religious. Today, sometimes what you find, one is too religious, the other isn't interested in the religion, and there becomes a friction at home. Imam al-Sadiq, when he married Hamida, he could have easily said, I'm the Imam, I'm knowledgeable, you just act as my wife. No, this wife of mine, both of us will become religious together. Both of us will gain knowledge of each other. Both of us will bounce off each other with our understanding of Islam. And therefore you found when you had a mother who is knowledgeable and a father who is knowledgeable, then naturally the young Imam Musa al-Kadhim would come out extremely knowledgeable. Imam Musa al-Kadhim, at the age of 5, was teaching Abu Hanifa lessons about Islam. Would you believe this or no? If you go to Pakistan and India and you ask the people, what is your jurisprudence? And they reply to you, we are Hanafi. Say to them, did you know not only that Imam al-Sadiq taught Abu Hanifa, but that if Imam al-Sadiq used to be busy, Imam al-Kadhim at the age of 5 used to answer on his behalf. Abu Hanifa comes home one day to Imam al-Sadiq. He knocks at the door and Imam al-Sadiq emerges. When Imam al-Sadiq and Imam al-Kadhim emerges, when Imam al-Kadhim emerges, Abu Hanifa says to him, is your dad here? He said, yes he is, he's just a bit busy. Abu Hanifa said, then I'll wait. Imam al-Kadhim said, no, is there anything I can help you with? Abu Hanifa said, no, no, I think your dad can answer it for me. He said, no, no, ask me. He said, young man, Musa, when we commit a sin, is it Allah who makes us sin? Is it us and Allah? Or is it us alone who commit a sin? It's a question many of us ask, isn't it? When I commit a sin, is Allah making me sin? Is it me and Allah? Or do I have the freedom of choice? Imam Musa ibn Ja'far said, oh Abu Hanifa. And know one thing, that Abu Hanifa was at an old age when Imam Musa ibn Ja'far answered him with this. He said to him, oh Abu Hanifa, if it is Allah who makes us commit a sin, then it's not fair he puts us in hell when he made us commit the sin. If it is us and Allah, once again it's not fair that we are punished when he was part of the crime. Therefore it is us who have been given the choice of free will. We can either stay away from sin or we can continue sinning. Imagine Abu Hanifa at his old age, Imam Musa ibn Ja'far at the age of 5 is already answering questions for him. Then on another occasion you find Abu Hanifa comes to Imam al-Sadiq one day. He says to him, Ja'far ibn Muhammad, I saw your son Musa al-Kadhim praying today. I saw him, but I don't think he knows how to pray properly. Imam al-Sadiq looked at him, he said, what do you mean? He said, when I walked past him in salah, when someone walked past him in salah, he didn't stick his hand out. Our brothers in other schools in Islam, if you walk past them in salah, do not be surprised if their hand comes out like that. The reason is understandable that they say that you shouldn't walk past someone in salah, try and walk behind them. Sometimes you will walk past, inadvertently you'll see someone who'll actually put their hand out like that. So he said to Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, he said to Musa al-Kadhim, the young boy, doesn't know how to read his prayers properly. Go and teach him. Imam al-Sadiq said, oh Abu Hanifa, why don't you go and teach Imam al-Kadhim? Teach, you go and teach him. Abu Hanifa said, very well. He came to Imam Musa ibn Ja'far. Imam is young, 5 years old. He said to him, young man, I need to teach you about salah. Musa ibn Ja'far said to him, go ahead. He said, when someone walks past you in your salah, you must put your hand out and block them when they walk past you. Because I just saw someone walk past you now and you didn't bother blocking them. Imam Musa ibn Ja'far said, oh Abu Hanifa, Allah says that he is closer to me than my jugular vein. While I was praying, I was so focused on my Lord, I didn't see any human being walk past me. Therefore you find at that young age, Imam Musa ibn Ja'far, from the student of his dad and his African mother Hamida, was able to achieve this prowess. And that's why many people were in awe of the young Imam Musa ibn Ja'far, I tell you. Many people used to love him because they saw a young man who had all the pleasures of the world in front of him but went towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Holy Prophet used to say, Allah loves to see nothing more than a youth who turns away from all of these forbidden acts and turns towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imam Musa ibn Ja'far, at a young age, you find that there was a small house. People would say, when we walk past the small house, we'd know that the young Musa ibn Ja'far would be in that house. And we could hear him reciting his prayers in the most beautiful voice. And you could see the tears coming down from his eyes. And you would hear him say, Ya Muhsin, Qad Ataka al-Musi. Oh, doer of good, and oh, you who is all good, the sinner has come to you. You find here that from that young age he was in this small house. And you know what the irony is? Imam Musa ibn Ja'far in that small house, and you had the caliphs in his time in the largest of palaces. Imam Musa ibn Ja'far in that small house, the caliphs. Do you know how many caliphs he lived under? He lived under the Caliph Al-Saffah and Mansur, and under Al-Hadi, and under Al-Mahdi, and under Harun Rashid. All of them had palaces. Wallah, if you go to Baghdad, go and see the palaces of all of these Khulafa. You see, for example, Dar al-Raqiq. You see Qasr al-Khul. You see Qasr al-Shakiriya. All of these palaces. And Imam Musa ibn Ja'far had a small house. Today in Baghdad, I ask you, those people, where are all their palaces? And look at the grand palace of Imam Musa ibn Ja'far alayhi salam. Imam Musa ibn Ja'far, therefore, at that young age, he had that ability where he was already in his closeness, in his piety, in his worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why, what do you find? You find Imam Musa ibn Ja'far was 20 years old when his father died. When Imam al-Sadiq died, Mansur tried to play a trick which Imam al-Sadiq destroyed him in. Mansur, when Imam al-Sadiq died, decided that these imams have to be killed off from the beginning. There's no point letting them live. So Mansur wrote to his governor in Medina. He said, I have heard the news that Ja'far ibn Muhammad has died. find out in his wasiyah who has he written to be the leader after him, and behead the person. The governor in Medina was called Sulaiman. Sulaiman got the will of Imam al-Sadiq. When he got the will, Sulaiman said, let me look, who's he written? Okay, Imam al-Sadiq has done this, make sure you pray salah, make sure you bury me, make sure. And my successors are five. Mansur al-Dawaniqi. Subhanallah. I tell you, these imams, wallah, we have them as a source of pride. Successor number one, Mansur al-Dawaniqi. Number two, Sulaiman, the one who's reading it. This person, his face became blue after he read this. Successor number three, Abdullah. Successor number four, Hamida. Successor number five, Imam Musa ibn Ja'far. Now Sulaiman is thinking, what do I do? As in number one, Mansur is saying, behead whoever's on this list. And I'm on this list. And Mansur's on the list. And Musa ibn Ja'far's on the list. And also Hamida, Imam al-Sadiq's wife, is on the list. Abdullah's on the list. So he wrote back to Mansur Dawaniqi. Mansur Dawaniqi said, Has there any post come? His servant said, yes, one letter came today. He said, give it to me quickly. The letter is, Imam al-Sadiq's written down who his successor is meant to be. Mansur's like, continue, what does it say? Mansur al-Dawaniqi number one, Sulaiman number two, Abdullah. Mansur said, wait, what are you talking about? He said, master, you said behead whoever it is, you're one of them. Yeah. Mansur said, very well, leave these people alone, leave them. Because if I have to behead the others, that means I have to get someone to behead me as well. If we're going to act out the will, Alhamdulillah, Imam Musa ibn Ja'far, when this happened, was allowed to begin his imama at the age of 20. And what do you find when he began his imama? The first thing people noticed in his imama was that he was a man who was able to restrain his anger, however much disrespect you showed him. Because I tell you, when we say his title is al-Kazim, do you know what al-Kazim means? In the Quran, in chapter 3, verse 134, there is the verse which says, "Wal-Kazimin al-Ghayb." Kazim means the one who is able to restrain his anger in a moment of difficulty. Imam Musa ibn Ja'far, when they called him al-Kazim, do you know why? Because when he received the imamate at the age of 20, there were people who used to insult him and curse him. And never in his life did he ever reply back to them. And that's why each one of us should be a Kazim. There's no point saying assalamu alayka ya Musa ibn Ja'far if we don't have al-Kazim in our life. How many of us have an anger problem? When you look in the mirror, sometimes don't you admit you have an anger problem? And then when you have that anger problem, ask yourself, why am I not like my Imam Musa ibn Ja'far al-Kazim? When he was al-Kazim, Allah praised him by saying he's a man, when he's angry, he restrains. Because one day Imam Musa ibn Ja'far was walking, this man came up to him and said to him, curse on your father and on you. Honestly, how do you reply to people like this? I don't know, is this a human or an animal? Curse be on you and on your father. The companions of Imam Musa ibn Ja'far wanted to approach the man. Imam said, wait, leave him, finished. He said to me, curse on me and my father, leave him. A couple of days later, Imam Musa ibn Ja'far said, how do you think we should approach this man? And it is vital when we hear these stories of the Ahlulbayt, let's implement their attributes in our life, please. Al-Kazim, restraining our anger. He asked his companions, how should we treat this man who cursed Imam al-Sadiq and cursed me? They said, Imam, we should punish him. We should attack him. We should confiscate his... He said, no. He said, leave this man to me. A few days later, Imam walked towards the garden of this man. He inquired about him. They said, he's in his garden. Imam walked towards the garden of this man. When he walked towards his garden, as he entered the garden, the man said, what are you doing here, you son of... Imam looked at him and said, what's the problem? He said, you've already damaged my garden with your footsteps. Imam said to him, how much have you spent on this garden? He said, 100 dinar. He said, how much do you expect to make from it? He said, 200 dinar. He said, here, take. When the man counted it, it was exactly 300 dinar. The man looked at Imam al-Kadhim, he said, but look at the way I cursed you. I cursed Ja'far al-Sadiq and I cursed you. He said, we the Ahlul Bayt have been taught to instill akhlaq, not only in the lives of the people, but in our life as well. I could easily reply back to you, but I want you to understand that as humanity, we can never survive if each one of us is going to attack each other like that. People would call him al-Kadhim, another person would say, wallah, I saw him as al-Kadhim when one day in his house, someone dropped water all over his abba. And the person looked at him and said, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, al-Kadhimin al-Ghayz. Imam said, I have restrained my anger. Wal-Afina an-Nas. Imam said, I have forgiven you. Wallah yuhibbul muhsineen. Imam said, I have freed you for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That attribute of Imam al-Kadhim was at the beginning of his life, and later he would need it when he was in prison for more than 15 years of his life. But it was that attribute where people would then respect him in his knowledge. Do you know why? If your akhlaq is good, people will listen to your knowledge. If your knowledge is good without akhlaq, no one will listen to you. Imam Musa ibn Ja'far first had to establish to the people that you can see my morals, now trust me when I have knowledge. I am sincere in giving you this knowledge. That's why one day, Imam Musa ibn Ja'far is walking. He goes past the house where music is being played. When he walks past the house where music is being played, he sees a lady sweeping the floor outside the house. He says to her, may I ask you a question? She says, go ahead. He said, is the owner of the house a free man or a slave? She said to him, of course, he is a free man. Imam replied, yes, definitely, because if he was a slave, he'd know which master was watching him. She heard him and she thought, you know, I've never thought about it like this. If truly I am an abd of Allah, then how am I not respecting my master by playing music at home? Do you know what the narration say? She went back in the house. Her husband said to her, what happened? She said, oh, I was just talking to someone outside. The husband said, what did the person say? She said, I don't know. He looked like a very humble man. And he just asked me a question. The husband said, what was the question? She said, the question was, is the owner of the house where music is being played, is the owner of the house a free man or a slave? So I said to him, he's a free man. So he said, what did he say then? She said, I heard him say, yes, definitely he's a free man, because if he was a slave, he'd know that the master was watching him. That person said, can you describe him to me? She said, yes. He had this complexion and this look and this beard and this height. He said, that is Musa ibn Ja'far. He ran out of the house without even wearing his slippers. He ran and looked for Imam Musa ibn Ja'far until he found him. He said, oh Imam, forgive me. Wallah, I have never thought of music the way you said it. In the past, I heard people say music is haram, but it didn't convince me. But the way you described it makes sense. How can I play music in a house and I claim to be a servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? That person, do you know what the Imam said to him? He said, do not worry. If you regret it and you perform tawbah, Allah will forgive you. That person today, the Sufis respect him very highly. They call him Bishr al-Hafi. Al-Hafi in Arabic means the one who walks barefooted. They called him Bishr al-Hafi because he ran out of his house to Musa ibn Ja'far barefooted. But look at the lesson Imam Musa ibn Ja'far taught. He didn't say to him straight in his face, music is haram, you're going to be punished if you listen to music. No. He said, how in salah are you saying that you are an abd of Allah, yet in your house you are listening to the people who oppose Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Today, in Muslim households, or in Muslim weddings, or in Muslim gatherings, Music, it's normal for a Muslim to come and play music. And when you see them and you say, what is this music that's being played? They say, well, you know what, at the end of the day, it's a celebration day and it's a one-off occasion. I remember one scholar saying that they said to me when I asked them on the first son's wedding, what is this? The father said, you know, it's my first son, please. When it was the second son, the father said, you know, it's my second son. When it was the third son, the father said, you know, this is the last one and that's it. There's none after this. You want to begin your first day in halal or in haram? You find Imam Musa ibn Ja'far said, is the house a person free or a slave? If he is a slave of Allah, he would never play such a thing. In other words, what did you find whenever Imam Musa ibn Ja'far would advise? There was a rational side to his advice. But truly, that aspect of him being kadhim was needed in his life. Why? Because I tell you, the amount of oppression they showed the Shia at that time was phenomenal. There has never been a period in Islamic history when the Shia of Al-Muhammad has been oppressed like when Imam Musa ibn Ja'far was Imam. I tell you, if you were to read the Khulafa who he had to live under, Shia could not even practice their faith. Do you know how the Shia had to practice? They had to employ taqiyya. Taqiyya is when you conceal your belief because you are in a state of life or death. Amongst the people who had to perform taqiyya, because of that time, you found many of the great companions of Imam al-Kadhim. Ibrahim al-Ja'fi, Ahmed al-Halabi, Ahmed al-Bazanti, amongst others, had to conceal their faith because of Imam Musa ibn Ja'far and because of the caliphs of the time. Because you know what these caliphs were doing? These caliphs were terrorizing any Shia of Al-Muhammad. Do you know Imam al-Rida has a hadith? When I read it, I couldn't believe the hadith. And tomorrow, inshallah, we discuss Imam al-Rida. Imam al-Rida says that if it wasn't for the event of Karbala, the worst tragedy to have affected our Ahlulbayt was the tragedy of Fakh. When I read Fakh, I decided to go and do my research. What is the tragedy of Fakh? For Imam al-Rida to say the worst tragedy which affected our Ahlulbayt was the tragedy of Fakh. Da'bal bin Ali al-Khuza'i even has poetry about their graves in Fakh. Do you know what happened in Fakh? After Al-Mansur died, who became the caliphs? You had the brothers, you had Hadi and Mahdi. Hadi al-Abbasi had a governor in Medina who used to oppress the Shia so much that he made them every morning and every evening, if you were a Shia living in Medina, you had to come to his palace and sign up. Sign up, what does sign up mean? Means you literally just have to come sign your name so he knows that what you're doing or where you're hiding or what your movements are. Every Shia, man, woman, child, has to come in the morning, has to come in the evening and sign in the palace. In that time, the cousins of Imam Musa ibn Ja'far, Hussein bin Ali al-Khair, Hassan al-Aftas, this governor of Medina, the governor of Hadi, caught Hassan al-Aftas and whipped him 200 times in public for being a follower of Ahlul Bayt. And on top of that, he spread out to the people that this man, because we caught him drinking, we have to punish him and we need to parade his body on a donkey. Hussein ibn Ali al-Khair, cousin of Imam Musa al-Kadhim, went to this governor. He said, listen, number one, I know my cousin was not drinking. Number two, the punishment for drinking alcohol in Islam is 80 lashes. Why have you punished him 200 lashes? Number three, in Islam, you don't parade a body on a donkey. That person said to him, who are you to speak to me like that? You and your Shia can't even practice your faith in my time. You have to come to my palace in the morning and in the evening. Get out. This Hussein bin Ali al-Khair decided to tell all the Shia, rise, let's not sit and watch. This person is torturing us and we should not just sit there and watch this oppression. The narration was that Hassan al-Aftas went to the top of this man's palace. He removed him. He said, Hayya ala salah, hayya ala al-falah, hayya ala khayr al-amal. Everyone rise. The family of Ahlul Bayt rose under the leadership of Hussein and Hussein's sister Zainab. Do you see how history repeats itself? 100 years after Karbala, Hussein from the grandsons, Zainab from the granddaughters. This Hussein raises all of Al-Muhammad, 232 members of Al-Muhammad. Went to rise against these people. And you know what that Hussein told Zainab? Subhanallah, how history repeats itself. Hussein told Zainab, he said to her, my sister Zainab, when the blood reaches your ankles, then this paper of our followers, let it go with the blood, because we don't want our followers, if we die, to be caught. When Hussein got killed, that governor, do you know what he did? He took all the children of Al-Muhammad who survived. He took them to Baghdad to the Khalifa of the time, Al-Hadi. All these children were sitting in front of Al-Hadi. Imagine you've got lots of children of Ahlul Bayt, grandchildren of Bibi Fatima. All of them in front of Al-Hadi. Al-Hadi looked at them, he said, who's these? They said, the grandkids of Fatima al-Zahra. He said, oh, they are the ones related to Musa ibn Ja'far? Said yes. He said, very well, bring me a sword. They said to him, what are you going to do? He said, I want you to make them all stand next to each other. Let's see how many heads I can cut at the same time. Today you have followers of Ahlul Bayt who say it's hard for me to be religious. I tell them, you don't know an inch of those who came before you. He got his sword and he beheaded them one by one, the grandchildren of Fatima al-Zahra. Imam al-Ridha said, were it not for the incident of Karbala, the worst incident to affect us was the incident of Fakh. وَأُخَرَى بِفَخٍ, graves which survived in Fakh. When this Hadi, he told everyone there, he said, I swear, this whole uprising is because of Musa ibn Ja'far. Abu Yusuf al-Qadhi was there, he said, no, Musa ibn Ja'far, I can swear on my children. Musa ibn Ja'far did not tell anyone to rise. This Hadi said, don't worry, I'll find Musa ibn Ja'far and I'll kill him. The narrations, what do they say to us? The narrations say, the people of Musa ibn Ja'far said to him, that Imam, do you know who said this to him? Yaqtin, the father of Ali bin Yaqtin. Yes? Yaqtin said, Imam, be careful. This Al-Hadi al-Abbasi wants to come and find you and he wants to kill you. The narrations come and say to us that Imam Musa ibn Ja'far said, let me just recite Salah. He went to recite Salah. Then he recited Dua, Jawshan al-Saghir. Then after finishing Jawshan al-Saghir, he said, do not worry. You will hear news shortly that Al-Hadi al-Abbasi has just died. The news then came, Hadi al-Abbasi had just passed away. After Al-Hadi al-Mahdi, after Al-Mahdi, the worst caliph to treat an Imam of Ahlul Bayt, Harun al-Rashid. Harun al-Rashid, if he found out you were Shia, you were beheaded. Harun al-Rashid would not allow anyone to come out and say they were Shia. Do you know how they used to have majalis in those days? Look at us today, alhamdulillah. Thousands of people sitting in a lecture, listening to the majalis of Ahlul Bayt. Do you know in those days what they would do? You would sell butter. While you're selling the butter, you teach your fellow Shia about Ahlul Bayt. As soon as the guard of Harun al-Rashid walks past, you then say, okay, 3 kilograms of butter, I will get it for you, don't worry. And that's why some of the greatest companions of Imam al-Kadhim, when Harun al-Rashid put Imam al-Kadhim in prison, some of his greatest companions had to come and ask him, what shall we do? Amongst them, Bahlul. You think Bahlul is a simple companion? Bahlul was a student of Imam al-Sadiq and Imam al-Kadhim. Bahlul came to Imam al-Kadhim in prison. He said, Imam, him and 2 other companions. They came to Imam al-Kadhim. They said, Imam, you are in prison. What shall we do? We your followers. How do we spread your word? Imam said, Jim. Jim? Imam said, Jim. The first one thought, Jim, part of the Arabic alphabet, Alif, Ba, Ta, Tha, Jim. The first one thought, Jim means Jabal, mountains. So he went to live in the mountains. The second one thought, Jim, Jala, Anil, Watan. So he went to live in another country. Bahlul said, I know what Jim is. Jim is Junoon. I'm going to act Majnoon. Crazy. But in my insanity, I will spread the word of Musa ibn Ja'far. Do you know what a sacrifice it is to act insane so you protect the teachings of an imam? Do you know what sacrifice that is? I don't think we know. We don't know what that sacrifice is, brothers and sisters. We today, when you ask us to be religious, I'm not ready yet. Ready? You think anyone's waiting for you? This ship has sailed. If you've studied the lives of the imams and you're still thinking, I'm not ready yet. No one, move away. Rather look at someone like Bahlul and say, Bahlul has to act insane to preserve the teachings. And wallah, Bahlul, the way he used to act, you would see a man who acts insane, but his words are words of wisdom. One day, Bahlul is sitting down on the throne of Harun al-Rashid. And he's jumping up and down, jumping. The people came, they started hitting him. Bahlul, get off. And he kept on jumping and jumping on the throne. All of a sudden, they came, they hit him and they removed him. He began to cry. Harun al-Rashid walked in. He looked at Bahlul crying, said, why is Bahlul crying? The guard said, oh, our master, he's crying because he was sitting on your throne. And how dare anyone sit on the throne of our master? Harun al-Rashid said, Bahlul, is that why you're crying? He said, no. He said, then why? He said, I cry for someone like you. How could you sit on the throne of the sons of Fatima to Zahra? What will you answer your Lord on the day of judgment? And then all of a sudden, he'll run away on a broomstick. Harun al-Rashid will look at him and think, this guy's crazy, but will also know the bullet hit. On another occasion, Bahlul tells Harun al-Rashid, give me the keys to the prisons of Baghdad. Please give me them. Harun al-Rashid said, what do you want to do with them? He said, I just want to play. Harun al-Rashid said, okay, take them. An hour later, the guards come. Harun, there is trouble. Harun al-Rashid said, what's the trouble? He says, all the prisoners have been released. Harun said, oh my God, Bahlul. Where is Bahlul? They said, he's in the graveyard, he's sitting down. Harun al-Rashid came up to me, saw Bahlul crying. He's like, Bahlul, didn't I tell you don't mess about with these keys? Why did you release them? Bahlul said, please, I'm sorry, please. Bahlul then said, is there any way I can be forgiven? Harun al-Rashid said, yes. Bahlul said, what is it? He said, if you make sure they're all caught, then I'll forgive you. Bahlul said, very well, let's stay in this graveyard because there'll be a day when all of them will come here. Harun al-Rashid one day tells Bahlul, Bahlul, you are insane. I know you're crazy. But sometimes you say some extraordinary things. I don't know where you got them from. He doesn't know he got them from Musa al-Kadhim. He said to him, Bahlul, you know there is Sirat on the day of judgment, on Qiyamah. How will it feel when we're on that Sirat to heaven or hell? Bahlul said, I don't know. He said, no, tell me. He said, okay, I do know. He said, what is it? He said, get me a pot. He said, okay, I'll get you a pot. He bought the pot. He said, put some water in the pot. He put some water in the pot. He then said to him, light a fire under it. Let it boil. Harun says, okay, we'll boil the water. There is fire. Bahlul said, now put a plate on top of it. On top of the pot. Harun said, okay, I'll put this big plate. Bahlul said, now we have to play a game. He said, what is it? He said, I have to stand on the pot and I have to say what I eat every day and what I drink every day and what I own in this dunya. And I have to say it, but I can't get off even though the fire is under me. And then you have to get on and you have to say what you eat and what you drink and what you own in this dunya. So Bahlul got on. He said, my name is Bahlul. I eat a bit of bread, I drink a bit of water, and I don't own anything in this dunya. And he got off. Now it's your turn. My name is Harun Rashid. I drink alcohol, and I drink, and I also eat. I eat, then he jumped off. Balu said, what's wrong? We didn't even get to the things you own and you jumped off already. So he said to him, what do you mean? He said, I just get boiled a bit of fire and you couldn't handle it. How will you handle the salat when Allah asks you about your life? In other words, this Bahlul, do you think he acted insane because he wants to? No human wants to act insane. But he knew Imam Musa ibn Ja'far told him, so he preserves the teachings of Ahlulbayt. Likewise, Ali ibn Yaqtin was the minister for Harun al-Rashid. First, when he came towards Ahlulbayt, he wrote a letter to Imam al-Kadhim. He said, Imam, how do us, the followers of Ahlulbayt, do our wudu? Imam Musa al-Kadhim wrote back to him, he said, we perform our wudu by washing our face, and then washing our hands, and then wiping our head, and then washing our feet. Ali ibn Yaqtin said, when I read the letter, I'm like, washing our feet? We don't wash our feet. We wipe our feet. But Imam Musa ibn Ja'far would not make a mistake. So what do I do? Do I wash or do I wipe? Someone who was jealous of Ali ibn Yaqtin told Harun al-Rashid, I think that Ali ibn Yaqtin is a lover of Musa al-Kadhim. Harun al-Rashid said to him, why? He said, because I've seen him talk about him, and he talks about him in a pleasant way. Harun al-Rashid said, Ali ibn Yaqtin would never leave my way. This is not true. That person said, no it is, I promise you it is. Harun al-Rashid said, very well, tomorrow I will find out. The person said, how? He said, we'll go and spy on Ali ibn Yaqtin in wudu. You know, there's a moment in your life where you either unconditionally submit to your imam, or you pick and choose what of Islam you like. Isn't it?
Thank you.
Ali ibn Yaqtin is reading a letter where Musa ibn Ja'far says to him, wash. Ali ibn Yaqtin knows you have to wipe. But if Musa ibn Ja'far says wash, then you have to wash. Harun al-Rashid is watching through the window. Ali ibn Yaqtin is doing his wudu, washes his face, washes his hands, wipes his head. And now the crunch time. Do I listen to my imam or do I make up my own Islam? As he's coming to his feet, he says, I have to listen to my imam. He began washing his feet. Harun Rashid said, I told you he hasn't joined Musa al-Kadhim. Look, he washes his feet like we wash our feet. Imam directed them that do not worry, if I'm in prison, you can be my representatives when I'm away. And that's why when people today say to me, Sayyid Ammar, we are with an imam who's in Ghaiba. We already had an imam called Musa ibn Ja'far in Ghaiba. And do you know why he put him in prison? You know why Harun al-Rashid put him in prison? Two acts, two reasons. The first reason is Harun al-Rashid looks at Imam Musa ibn Ja'far one day. He said to him, why do you, the sons of Ali ibn Abi Talib, think you're better than us, the sons of Abbas? Remember, these are cousins. Imam al-Kadhim is from the line of Abu Talib. Harun al-Rashid is from the line of Abbas. Abu Talib and Abbas are brothers. But sometimes cousins can hate each other, not just love each other. The narration states that Harun al-Rashid said, why do you think you're better than us? Imam Musa ibn Ja'far said, Harun, we come from Abu Talib, you come from Abbas. Rasulullah's father Abdullah is from the same father and mother as Abu Talib. Whereas Abbas, his mother is different. Harun al-Rashid said then, but Abu Talib died and Abbas remained alive. And the heritage of Rasulullah remains with Abbas, not Abu Talib. Imam al-Kadhim said, yes, but the heritage of Rasulullah remains in his child, not in his uncle. And we are the sons of Fatima. At that moment, Imam al-Kadhim said, oh Harun al-Rashid, if Rasulullah came to propose for your daughter, would you give your daughter to him? Harun al-Rashid said, yes, it would be my honor. Imam said, but he wouldn't for us, because he is the father of our mother. He would never come to us. Therefore, our line is a straight connection, whereas yours is an indirect connection. Harun Rashid was not happy with this. It brought an envy, but he still needed a rumor to be spread. Do you know who he paid to spread a rumor about Imam al-Kadhim? Imam's brother Ismail had a son called Ali. You know, today in the Muslim world, we have different sects. We have the Zaydis, the Ismailis, we have the Imami Ithna Asharis. And Ismail was the brother of Imam al-Kadhim, but from a different mother. The narrations, what do they say to us? The narrations say to us, Ismail had a son by the name of Ali. Yahya al-Barmaki told this Ali that we will pay you a certain amount of money. And by the way, Ismail died before Imam al-Sadiq. Ismail died before Imam al-Sadiq. Some of the Shia of the time believed, because Ismail is the eldest son, that means he should be the Imam after. And even if he's dead, his son should be the Imam. Whereas we say in the school of Ahlelbayt, it doesn't mean because you're the eldest son, you should be the Imam. It's who Allah has chosen who should be the Imam. Ali ibn Ismail, Yahya al-Barmaki told him, we'll pay you a certain amount of money if you come from Medina to Baghdad and you spread rumors about Musa ibn Ja'far. The narrations say, Ali ibn Ismail, Imam Musa ibn Ja'far's nephew, just before he left, Imam said to him, where are you going? He said, I'm going to Baghdad. He said, why? He said, I have debts which I need to pay. Imam said, Ali, I'll pay your debts. You don't need to go to Baghdad. The narration say, Ali said, no, I want to go. Give me a piece of advice, oh my uncle. Imam said, do not be the cause of the bloodshed of me and my family. And then he said, Ali, here's 300 dinar. One of Imam's companions said, Imam, why did you give him 300 dinar? Don't you know this man what he's going to do? Imam said, Rasulullah used to say, look after your relatives. If you look after your relatives, if your relatives do evil to you later, that's Allah's concern, not yours. You do good to your relatives. What they do after, Allah will judge them. You know this Ali? He went all the way to Harun al-Rashid. Harun al-Rashid was sitting down. Yahya al-Barmaki was sitting down. Harun al-Rashid said, what is it, Ali? He said, you know this Musa ibn Ja'far? He's sitting in Medina. He's collecting weapons. And he's raising an army to kill you. All for money. Imam Musa ibn Ja'far didn't raise any army. He didn't have any weapons. Harun al-Rashid said, oh people, did you hear this? They said, yes. He said, now do you allow me to put him in my prisons? The people said, yes. Ali ibn Ismail, Imam al-Kadhim's nephew, said, can I have my envelope? He gave him the envelope. When he went out to open the envelope, do you know how much was in the envelope? 200 dinar. How much did Imam al-Kadhim give him? 300. When he saw the 200, he couldn't believe it. He choked and he died at that moment. He let down his uncle, and from there Harun al-Rashid took over Imam al-Kadhim's life. Imam al-Kadhim, they moved him from prison to prison. More than 15 years he spent in prison. The first prison was in Basra. Then they took him to Qantara prison. Then they took him to the prison of Fadl ibn al-Rabi'. Do you know Fadl ibn al-Rabi'? Do you know one day what he said? You know Imam Musa al-Kadhim, when he first entered prison, you know what his first words were? Ya Allah, all my life I have asked you to give me the honor of worshipping you in a place alone. I now thank you that you've given me this honor. Would you say that if you were in prison? Would you? Ya Allah, all my life I've asked you to let me be in a place where I can worship you alone. Now thank you. Would you say that? Prison makes a human being get destroyed sometimes. Fadl ibn al-Rabi', when Imam Musa al-Kadhim was moved from Basra prison, then to Qantara prison, then to Fadl ibn al-Rabi'a's prison, Fadl ibn al-Rabi' told Ahmed al-Qazwini, he said to him, Ahmed, come with me to my prison. So he came. He said, what do you see in the prison? He said, I see a man. I see a white robe. He said, no, 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 look closer. He said, no, I see a white robe. He said, no, that's Musa ibn Ja'far in sujood. The whole time in prison, he studies in his sujood. He says, Harun al-Rashid sent the most beautiful girl in the whole of Arabia into Musa ibn Ja'far's prison. And when she entered the prison, she said to Musa ibn Ja'far, "Oh man, whatever you want from me, I'll give you." And he didn't reply. "Whatever you want, I'll give you." And he didn't reply. The third time she said, "Please, whatever you want, I'll give you. The Khalifa sent me." She says that he turned around to me and he said, "Oh lady, why would I want what you offer when Allah has offered more?" Said, by the time the guards entered the prison, they saw Musa ibn Ja'far in sujood and the lady behind him in sujood. And he sent people into the prison who didn't speak Arabic. They came out as Muslims. He said, "What's wrong with you? You people were meant to kill Musa ibn Ja'far." They said, "The man started speaking to us in our language. And we became Muslims from his words." Fadl ibn Rabi' used to say, "How can I torture a man? In the daytime he is fasting, in the night he is praying." Then after that they took him to the prison of Fadl bin Yahya, until at the end they took him to the prison of As-Sindi. As-Sindi. Do you know what his prison was? May Allah bless the soul of Imam Musa ibn Ja'far. All those years in prison. You know what his prison was? The other prisons, they were tight spaces. As-Sindi's prison was the type of prison where it's a narrow pole and they make you stand inside it so that you can't sit. And on top of that pole they put a rock so that you could not know the difference between day and night. And Imam Musa ibn Ja'far used to say to the guards, "I do not know the difference between the day and the night. When you want to pray your salah, I beg you come and tell me so I can at least attempt to pray my salah." And you know there is a hadith, which is a hadith which hurts you. That the one day they removed the rock, the time when they'd removed the rock from the top of his pole where he was in, he tried to look outside for some of the daylight. All of a sudden a man came and smacked him and hit him with his legs. And they began to kick the face of Imam Musa ibn Ja'far. Do you know how many people visit Imam Musa ibn Ja'far and don't cry by his grave? Do you know? Because they say, "We don't know anything about his life." No Imam of Ahlulbayt was tortured like Musa ibn Ja'far. No Imam. Aba Abdullah, there is no day like Aba Abdullah. But there are no years like Imam Musa al-Kadhim. And at the end, Imam Musa al-Kadhim in prison is the only Imam. And I say, "Ya Allah, I don't know how much they tortured Imam al-Kadhim in prison. But imagine an Imam." Normally Imams of Ahlul Bayt can take anything. Imagine Imam al-Kadhim, his last dua in prison, "Ya Allah, all my years I asked you to allow me to worship you alone, and I thank you for that honor. But Ya Allah, I beg you now, release me from the prison of Harun." So Ibn Suwayd narrates, Ali Ibn Suwayd narrates, "I came to Imam al-Kadhim, I got through to his prison. I spoke to him, I said, 'Imam Musa ibn Ja'far, when are you coming out? Your Shia are waiting.'" And Imam Musa ibn Ja'far said, "Oh Ali, on Friday in the morning on the bridge of Baghdad, I will be out. You know where I am heading." Ali says, "I went and told all our Shia, Imam Musa ibn Ja'far is going to be released. Let's all gather on the Friday on the bridge of Baghdad." He says, on the Friday we went to the bridge of Baghdad and we heard a man saying, "There is a janazah here." He said, "We went and we saw a body lying on the ground on the bridge of Baghdad." He said, "We came towards the body, we were wondering whose body is this. When we came near the body, we saw it was Imam Musa ibn Ja'far's body on the bridge." He says, we came near the body. He said, I had a doctor who was a Christian. I said to the doctor, oh doctor, come and look at this body. When the doctor came and looked at this body, the doctor looked at me and he said, does this man have any family? I said to him, why? He said, because they should ask for blood money. I said, why? He said, because the poison had surrounded his whole body. And that's why I tell you a story which I know of firsthand. Sheikh Ahmed Al-Wa'ili, may Allah bless his soul, one of the greatest reciters in Islamic history, he himself narrates, in Baghdad, one day I came home, my daughter, I saw her and I saw my wife crying. What's the problem? My daughter was playing with glass and the glass went through the eye and the whole eye opened up. So I went and got a doctor and the doctor said, your daughter will never see with this eye again. He said, I straight away thought, I'm going to Imam Musa ibn Ja'far's grave in Baghdad. May Allah grant you all that honor of that ziyarah. He said, I went to the grave of Imam Musa ibn Ja'far. I stood by the grave. I said, oh Imam, I have said you are Bab al-Hawa'id. Show me now. My daughter's eye is cut, she cannot see. He says, wallah, I returned home and my wife was smiling. I said to her, what is it? She said, look at your daughter. He said, I looked at my daughter, her eye was back in the same state again. He said, that day I realized the meaning of Bab al-Hawa'ij, Imam Musa ibn Ja'far. That when the Christian doctor came back, he saw her eye, he said, I cannot believe that the eye has come back like this. The eye was completely cut and now it's back to normal. Therefore, do not forget on a night like this to ask through Imam Musa ibn Ja'far. Ask your hawa'ij on a night like this. Raise your hands, brothers and sisters. Raise your hands if you can. Raise your hands and we pray to Allah to raise us with Imam Musa ibn Ja'far. The man who in his ziyarah we say, oh man who was put in the prisons of Harun al-Rashid. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for all our Muslim brothers around the Islamic world, especially our brothers in Bahrain and all our brothers who are facing hardship in the world today. We pray to Allah to raise us with Imam Musa ibn Ja'far alayhi salam, to allow us to receive his intercession in this world and the hereafter. For all our brothers who are ill, we pray to Allah in the name of the one who was ill at Karbala, Imam Zain al-Abidin. We pray to Allah with the following dua, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Amman yujibu al-Muttar idha da'ah wa yakshifu al-su' Amman yujibu al-Muttar idha da'ah wa yakshifu al-su' أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء. Inshallah, tomorrow we will continue with the biography of Imam Ali ibn Musa al-Ridha. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the Surah al-Fatiha, but before it, the loudest of your salawat.